This conference will now be recorded.
I request ma'am to please kindly start the session. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So my name is Priyanka. Good evening, everyone. So today I'm talking about a topic called photosynthesis in microbes. Especially I took this topic like in photosynthesis in microbes because I want to explain the difference between oxygenic photosynthesis and anoxygenic photosynthesis. Like we have different types of photosynthetic organisms. So in this topic, we'll be studying about like photosystems and photosynthetic pigments. I mean, in next classes, we'll be completely studying what are the reactions, what are the steps in photosynthesis. In this only, we are studying about what are photosystems and what are photosynthetic pigments and where are they located. So we'll start. So we'll start with what is the definition of photosynthesis. We have studied that there are different definitions for photosynthesis, like from starting onwards, like from childhood, we have studied different definition for the photosynthesis. But here I'm taking with a simple definition, like it is a photochemical process by which the photosynthetic organisms use light energy to drive the synthesis of organic compounds, which means the organisms which participate in the photosynthesis, they use a light energy and convert them into chemical energy in the form of organic compounds, which is none other than but carbohydrates, which we take as a food. So it is a photochemical physiochemical reaction, because here there are some reduction and oxidation processes takes place, and it is a chemical process. So here the photo organisms use light energy, and that light energy is derived or it is used for the synthesis of organic compounds. So in this process, in general, in photosynthesis process, firstly, the light energy is converted into chemical energy in the form of NADPH and ATP. So photosynthesis, as we have studied, the organic compounds are produced, means they are not directly produced in the form of carbohydrates. Initially, they are the first chemical compounds that are produced in the photosynthesis process are NADPH and ATP, which are the chemical compounds or the energetic compounds which are used later for the production of carbohydrates. That is, this chemical energy, this NADPH and ATP, this chemical energy is then used to reduce carbon dioxide into organic compounds. So we know that for a photosynthesis, we need sunlight, carbon dioxide, and water, that is later. So here, the light energy, initially the light energy is converted into chemical compounds like NADPH and ATP. These chemical energies, these are the energetic compounds which are used. These are used for the reduction of CO2 molecule, and this CO2 is reduced in the form of organic compounds, which are carbohydrates, which is generally the glucose. So next, the photosynthetically produced carbohydrates are the main source for the organisms to for the production of their food, and for all the non-photosynthetic organisms which consume them. So photosynthetically produced carbohydrates are the main source of the food for those organisms, along those which are non-photosynthetical, like heterotrophs, like all of the animals that are depending upon the photosynthetic organisms for food. And during the photosynthesis, we have a byproduct, A byproduct, molecular oxygen, is produced, which is the only source for the oxygen for the organisms to breathe. So all the organisms breathe oxygen, and they are used in for the respiration. So the oxygen is mainly produced by the plant, and those are the byproducts in the process of photosynthesis. Photosynthesis is carried out by many organisms, which are broadly classified into two types based upon the production of oxygen during the process. So photosynthesis is done by many types of organisms, but they are mainly classified into two types, that is based upon the oxygen are produced or not. So that is oxygenic photosynthetic organisms and anoxygenic photosynthetic organisms. Like in oxygenic photosynthetic organisms, they produce oxygen during the process. Means in these organisms, during the process of photosynthesis, they produce the oxygen, which includes the prokaryotes. All the prokaryotes are oxygenic. And cyanobacteria and eukaryotes like plants, and photosynthetic protista like diatoms and euglena. These are the oxygenic photosynthetic organisms which produce oxygen during the process of photosynthesis. So we'll be studying later how the oxygen is produced and why there are some of the organisms which are not producing the oxygen. So here, these are the examples, some prokaryotes, cyanobacteria, and eukaryotes like plants. All the plants are oxygenic photosynthetic organisms, and there are some of the protista like diatoms and euglena. These are also the oxygenic photosynthetic organisms. The other type of photosynthetic organisms are anoxygenic photosynthetic organisms. These are the organisms which cannot produce oxygen during the process, during the photosynthetic process. They include like prokaryotic organisms like green and purple photosynthetic bacteria, like green sulfur and non-sulfur, purple sulfur and non-sulfur bacteria are all belong to anoxygenic photosynthetic organisms. So meanwhile, if you have any doubts, you can ask me. Okay. So in photosynthetic organism, the photosynthetic chemical process is simplified as. So till now we have understood that. Okay, thank you. So till now we have understood that for photosynthesis, we require carbon dioxide, so which is reduced to the carbohydrates, and then water, and then light. So in oxygenic photosynthetic organisms, carbon dioxide, water, and solar energy gives glucose and oxygen. Like 6CO2 plus 6H2O plus solar energy gives rise to 6H12O6 plus O2. 6O2. So this 6O2 is the oxygen which is maximum present in the air. And C6H12O6 is a glucose molecule, and it is also written as, so during the process, some water molecule are also released. So carbon dioxide plus water plus solar energy gives rise to glucose plus oxygen plus water. So this water is in the presence of moisture in the air. They are released into the air. So finally, on the basis of this reaction, 6CO2 plus 12H2O, means here we are doubling, because half of the 6H2O molecules are released into the air, and half of the this remaining 6H2O molecules are used in the reaction. So 6CO2 plus 12H2O plus solar energy gives rise to C6H12O6 plus 6O2 plus 6H2O. This is in the oxygenic photosynthetic organisms. So here the water is used, and here oxygen is liberated. Hence they are called oxygenic photosynthetic organisms. And in anoxygenic photosynthetic organism, these are the organisms which grow in unfavorable conditions like These are the organisms which cannot be grown in the presence of oxygen, like anoxygenic photosynthetic organisms. So instead of water, they use some of the inorganic molecules like H2S, H2, and some of the sulfur compounds instead of water. Hence, they are not producing any O2 molecules. So the overall reaction for the photosynthesis in sulfur bacteria is CO2 plus 2H2S, hydrogen sulfide, plus light energy gives rise to carbohydrates plus water and sulfide molecule. Here, the oxygen is not liberated. Hence, they are anoxygenic photosynthetic organisms. They are not grown in the presence of oxygen. If they are exposed to oxygen, they'll die. So here, but they have to synthesize their own food material. So instead of water molecule, they are using different molecules, but they produce water molecule in their photosynthetic reaction. So after studying what are the different types of photosynthetic organisms, we have to jump in. What is a photosynthesis? What are the different steps? What are the different reactions that are included in the photosynthesis? So mainly photosynthesis is of two steps. It is done in two steps. One is light reaction and other is carbon fixation. So first we'll start with a light reaction. Light reaction is a reaction which takes place in the presence of light. That means requires direct energy of light to make ATP and NADPH, which is used in the next process. So light reaction is done in the presence of light. Here, the light energy is converted into chemical energy. So light energy is trapped in this reaction. It is called as light reaction. And next step is carbon fixation. It is also called, generally called as dark reaction, but the name suggests the dark reaction, which means most of the people will be saying that it takes place in the dark, and but this should not be told as a dark reaction. It is just told be like carbon fixation. Especially I have wrote this dark reaction, so I have to explain that it is not called as dark reaction because this is done in the presence of light and in absence of light. It doesn't matter if light present or absent. This takes place in the both presence and absence of light. The products of light reaction are used in the reduction or fixation of carbon dioxide to triphosphate, which means as we here the light energy is converted into chemical energy, as I said in the starting slide, like NADPH and ATP, those are produced in this light reaction. The energy from light is converted into chemical energy, which means the bond is formed, the reduction of the NADPH and ATPs are formed. Those energy compound, chemical compounds which are produced in the light reaction are used in this carbon fixation, for the carbon fixation, and for the, which means fixation of the carbon dioxide into triphosphates, which means glyceraldehyde phosphate, which is then finally converted into carbohydrates later. So initially the three carbon molecules are added or fixed into triose phosphates. Triose means three carbon sugars, and those are in phosphate form. So first reaction is light reaction, where light energy is trapped and converted into chemical energy, that is in the form of ATP and NADPH. And next reaction is carbon fixation, where the carbon dioxide, which is present in the atmosphere, is fixed, which it is reduced in the form of triose phosphates in the initial stage, and then it is converted into carbohydrates. So the reaction can be written like this, like two H2O molecules gives one O2 molecule. This is a byproduct. This we'll be studying later how this H2O molecule is used, but here we are mostly concerned with the what is the main system in the photosynthesis, like what are the pigments, what are the photosystems. In we'll be studying detail about what is a light reaction, what is a carbon fixation in later classes, but here we are simply studying what is a light reaction and what are the main proteins and pigments are used in a light reaction. Okay, so this H2O molecule gives rise to O2 and light reaction takes place, which give NADPH and ATP molecule. This NADPH and ATP are used in a dark reaction where CO2 molecules are converted into carbohydrates. So light reaction, as we know, that is entrapment of light. The dark reaction is different in different organisms. Like Kelvin cycle is done in oxygenic photosynthetic organisms, and like we all know that Kelvin cycle, C3 cycle is done in most of the plants and all the oxygenic photosynthetic organisms, like oxygen is released. And in anoxygenic photosynthetic organisms, there is a different dark reaction called reductive tricarboxylic acid or reverse tricarboxylic acid cycle, which takes place in green sulfur bacteria, and hydroxypropionate pathway. It is also a dark reaction in a green non-sulfur bacteria. These both are anoxygenic photosynthetic organisms. In these anoxygenic photosynthetic organisms, instead of Kelvin cycle, reductive tricarboxylic acid and hydroxypropionate pathway is done. So next we will study what is a light reaction and what are the pigments are used in a light reaction. So in the light reaction, the sunlight is trapped for the formation of chemical energy and also split the water molecule and release the oxygen into air. So the sunlight is that light energy is trapped and used for the formation of chemical energy. That light energy is used to split the water molecule. This water molecule is split into two forms, that is protons and oxygen. This oxygen is released into the air. The light reaction takes place at a particular place in a chloroplast, that is grana thylakoid, which contain antenna pigments present in the reaction center. So this light reaction takes place in the chloroplast, that is grana thylakoid, which contain all the pigments which are mainly used for the entrapment of the light, and this light energy is used to split the water molecule into protons and oxygen. In light reaction, water molecule split and gives electron, protons and oxygen, which is released into the air. So two H2O gives rise to four protons and four electrons and one oxygen molecule. This oxygen is released into the air, and these protons are mainly used for the ATP synthesis. And this electron is used for the electron transport, which is used for the synthesis of NADPH. The produced electron is transferred from the electron donor, that is H2O, to the acceptor of NADPH through a series of electron acceptor, and the proton gradient is caused the formation of ATP used in a dark reaction. As I said, the proton molecules are used for the production of NADPH, and this proton gradient is used for the formation of ATPs. In oxygenic photosynthetic organism, water is the proton and electron donor, and in oxygenic photosynthetic organism, hydrogen sulfide, hydrogen is an electron and proton donor. As I said, they are not using water. Instead of, they are using H2S, H2 and sulfide molecules. So in a chemical reaction, we have to say, like in oxygenic photosynthetic organisms, 6CO2 plus 2H2O in light, in the presence of light, gives glucose, oxygen and water. In anoxygenic photosynthetic organisms, this carbon along with carbon dioxide, the electron donor will be like H2S, H2, and in the presence of light, they are converted to carbohydrate and sulfide. Means here the A denotes the sulfide molecule, and water. Water is released in this process. So as I said, the light reaction takes place in the granite alkaloid. So this main light reaction is done in a photosystem. So next we'll be studying what is a photosystem. But before that, where is this photosystem is takes place? So the location of photosystems. In every photosynthetic organisms, there are some photosynthetic organelles like chloroplast or chlorosomes. Chloroplast is a specialized organelle which consisting of a thylakoid like this at the disc-like structures where the main light reaction takes place. And so inside this thylakoid, that place is called grana, and this spacious region is called stroma. So in this membrane consisting of all the proteins and pigments where the complete light reaction takes place, and those energy which are produced from the light reaction are used in the dark reaction which takes place in stroma. Means this spacious region between these thylakoids, means this disc-like structures. So inside the chloroplast it is called grana, and outside it is called stroma. That's what I said. So this is inside the thylakoid, this is grana, and outside the spacious region is called stroma. And photosynthetic pigments are present like on the thylakoid membrane. So the disc-like structure, this have a membrane. So that membrane is called thylakoid membrane, and this light reaction takes place in that particular membrane. And carbon fixation takes place in a stroma. So this is a chloroplast which is present in oxygenic photosynthetic organisms, and these are the chlorosome which is present in anoxygenic photosynthetic organisms. They are present attached to the plasma membrane. It is a plasma membrane and it is a chlorosome. The main difference between chloroplast and chlorosome are here, they are in the form of disc, they are in the form of rods. So all the pigments and some of the light entrapping proteins are present on these discs and rods. And the spacious region, in this spacious region, the main dark reactions takes place. So now we'll be studying what is a photosystem. So photosystem, it is also called as pigment system. Here the pigment molecules and proteins are bound forming a photosystem. Means all the, there are different types of pigments which are used for the entrapping of light, and some of the proteins which are used to transfer of electron from one system to other system, which forms the NADPH. So all those proteins and pigments bound to form a photosystem. And a particular photosystem consisting of two components, that is photochemical reaction center and Antinae complex. Here the photochemical reaction center, it is a center where the light energy is converted into the chemical energy, and the Antinae complex are the complex where the light energy is trapped and then it is transferred to the photochemical reaction center where the light energy is converted into chemical energy. This photochemical reaction center is of two types, like type 1 and type 2, based upon the presence of photosystem protein. Like there are two types of photosystem proteins, like PS1 and PS2. They are the photosystem proteins. PS1 is a iron sulfur type and PS2 is a pyophytine quinine type, which means, so So we have known that this is a thylakoid membrane. In this thylakoid membrane, we have different proteins and pigments. So in this diagram, we'll knowing that. So this is one of the photosynthetic protein, and there are some electron acceptors and donors along this thylakoid membrane. And this is another photosynthetic photosystem protein. We'll be studying one by one. So PS1 is an iron sulfur type, which means the electrons are transferred finally to iron or sulfur type of protein. And PS2 is a photosystem protein, which is pheophytin quinine type, which means the electrons from this PS2 is then transferred to the pheophytin and quinine type. Quinines, which is the electron acceptors and donor along the thylakoid membrane. PS2. So we'll be studying what is a PS1 and PS2, what are the components in that particular photosystems. So PS2, it is a protein and a pigment complex, means in the particular PS2 photosystem, there are different types of proteins and pigments. Mainly, it is called as pheophytin and quinine type because it is consisting of pheophytin and quinine as a electron donors and acceptors in a particular photosystem. It is also called as P680 because it absorbs light effectively at 680 nanometers. So, in a particular electromagnetic radiation from sun, there are different spectrums, different light energies of different wavelength. So this particular protein P680 absorbs light at 680 nanometers. It contains membrane proteins, chlorophyll, pheophytin, plastoquinone, and some cofactors, cytochrome B. So these are all the electron acceptors and donors so that it transferred to the next photosystem. Like here we'll be seeing this is one of the photosystem PS2, and then it transferred to the plastoquinine and plastocyanin, and they are transferred to the cytochrome B6BF and plastocyanin. So these are all the cofactors which act as electron acceptors and donors, which finally gives the electron to the PS1, that is photosystem 1. It is associated with the core antenna and peripheral antennae, which means this particular photosystem, around this particular photosystem, there are antenna pigments, like there are some of the pigments which are core, means which are mainly used in the entrapment of the light, and peripheral antennae around this photosystem, there are core antennae. Around the core antennae pigments, there are peripheral antennae pigments, which are also used in a light absorption. This peripheral antenna absorbs light and gives to core antennae. This core antenna gives the light energy and transferred to the PS1. This is a PS2. Initially, we'll be studying that PS2. Most of the people will be studying like PS2 initially because this is the first photosystem in a process in a electron transport, because it absorbs very less wavelength of light, that is 680 nanometers. But this PS1 is a photosystem which absorbs more than PS2, that is P700. So it absorbs light at very low wavelength, that is 680 nanometers. Hence, we'll be studying mostly firstly about PS2 because it is the first photosystem which absorbs light and releases the electron and continues the photochemical reaction. And next we'll come to the PS2. It is a protein pigment complex, use light energy to transfer the electron from plastocyanin and pyridoxine. As we studied, from electrons from PS2 is transferred to the PS1. This PS1 finally gives electrons to the pyridoxine, and finally NADPH is formed. So in here, the PS1 is used to transfer the electrons to plastocyanin and gives to the pyridoxine. It contains several proteins, chlorophyll A, carotenoids, phylloquinone, and FES center and other cofactors. So it is consisting of FES center, which means there are some of the proteins here. The main reaction center consisting of iron and sulfur center. Hence, this PS1 is also called as iron sulfur type. So as I said, they contain proteins and pigments. There are different types of proteins, and chlorophyll is a pigment. Chlorophyll, carotenoids, these are all the pigments, and phylloquinone and FES center and cofactors, they are used for the electron transfer, which is used in the light reaction. And it is also called as P700 because it absorbs light more effectively at 700 nanometers. And chlorophyll A associated with the different products will change the absorption properties of this PS1. So if we see, this is a photosystem 1. So from PS2 or from finally, that is plastocyanin, energy is transferred to the PS1. So these are all the antennae complexes which are present around the particular reaction center. This is the reaction center, photosystem 1. All these antennae pigments absorbs the light energy from the sun and transfer one by one finally to the reaction center, PS1, where it gives the electron to the primary acceptor and ferredoxin, which finally use the electrons for the reduction of NADP into NADPH in the presence of this particular enzyme. So it is also consisting of core antennae complex and peripheral antennae complex, which means this is a reaction center where it absorbs the light energy and converts this light energy into chemical energy. Around this photosystem, there are some of the antennae molecules, and around these are the core antennae molecules. Around these, there are some of the peripheral antennae molecules, which are also used in the light absorption of light. So the ratio between PS2 and PS1 is 1.5:1, which means there are more PS2 molecule than PS1. The ratio is 1.5:1. So we have studied. So in light reaction, we know that there are in photosystem, we know that there are two, the photochemical reaction center and antennae complex. The photochemical reaction center is the way the light energy is converted into chemical energy. The antennae complexes are the pigments which are used for the trapping of the light, sunlight. So we will be studying what are the antennae pigments, what are the different pigments which are used for the light, which are used for the entrapping of the sunlight. There are different types of antennae pigments or normal pigments which are mainly used in the entrapment of the light based upon different organisms. So we'll be studying all the different types of pigments here. So antennae pigments, it is a light harvesting complex consisting of different pigments which absorbs light and transfer to the reaction center by resonance energy transfer method. So antennae pigments are the main complex molecules, means they are some of the pigments which absorbs the light from the sun, and those are transferred finally to the reaction center. So as I said, these are the some of the pigments which absorbs the light from the sun, and they are transferred one by one by the resonance mechanism finally to the where the chemical reaction takes place. So the transfer of reaction center by resonance reaction energy transfer. So that particular energy which are trapped by the sun is transferred from one antenna pigment to another antenna by the resonance energy transfer. So these antenna pigments in higher plants, they are mostly the chlorophyll. There in a particular cell, there are like 200 to 300 chlorophyll molecules in the plants. So here we are taking example like plants. There are two components in a particular pigment, antenna pigments. There are two components. Those are inner core or inner antenna and peripheral outer antenna, which I said. So around the particular photosystem, there are core or inner antenna molecules, and around the core or inner antenna molecule, they present a peripheral antenna molecules. So there are different types of pigments like chlorophyll, carotenoids, and phycobilins. We'll be studying the structure of chlorophyll, carotenoids, and phycobilins. So chlorophyll is a main pigment which are mostly seen in all the oxygenic photosynthetic organism. We'll be studying those are green color and all the plants consisting of chlorophyll. Along with that, all the oxygenic photosynthetic organisms consisting of chlorophyll. So chlorophyll is the main pigments which are seen in maximum most of the photosynthetic organisms. These are present only in oxygenic photosynthetic organisms, and there are different types. Those are chlorophyll A, chlorophyll B, chlorophyll C, and chlorophyll D. So we know that all the plants are oxygenic photosynthetic organisms. So along with those, there are different types of oxygenic photosynthetic organisms in prokaryotes and eukaryotes. So each of the organism consisting of different ratios of these chlorophyll molecules. So most of the organisms consisting of chlorophyll A and B, but there are only some of the organisms consisting of chlorophyll C and D. Because this chlorophyll A and chlorophyll B have the high maximum capacity to absorb light and transfer to the photochemical reaction center. So these chlorophyll molecules are lipid soluble and can absorb light at blue and red region of the where they are visible light, and poor at a green portion of the electromagnetic spectrum. So we know that electromagnetic spectrum consisting of different colors, WebGR. So in that particular WebGR spectrum, these particular chlorophyll molecules can absorb light at blue and red regions and poor at green portions. So I heard that all the colors we'll be seeing are the reflections of the particular color which are not absorbed by them. So these are the chlorophyll molecules, they don't absorb green light. So we are seeing that particular green light which are reflected by those chlorophyll molecules, and those are lipid soluble, and mostly it is a chlorine structure or porphyrin structure. If we are studying the chemical structure of this chlorophyll, it is a chlorine, that is chlorophyll A, B, and D are chlorine chemical structure, and this chlorophyll C is a porphyrin derivative. So what is a chlorine? What is a chlorine derivative means? Chlorine is a large heterocyclic aromatic ring which consisting of 5 pyrrole rings. Pyrrole means 5 carbon atom ring with 4 carbons and 1 nitrogen atom. So chlorine is a aromatic compound, means it is a cyclic compound which consisting of 4 carbon and 1 nitrogen atom. So a particular chlorine consisting of pyrrole and pyrroline rings, which is a dihydropyrrole with a different position of double bonds. These aromatic compounds like pyrrole rings also consisting of double bonds between the 4 carbon and 1 nitrogen atom. Those double bonds are different in pyrroline rings, and they are attached with each other by the methionine double bond CH group. So we'll be studying this in chemical structure of the chlorophyll in the next slide. And porphyrin, it consisting of four pyrrole rings, as we have studied what is a pyrrole. So porphyrin C means, that is, chlorophyll C is a porphyrin derivative. This porphyrin consisting of only four pyrrole rings, this doesn't consisting of pyrroline ring. So this is the chemical structure of a particular chlorophyll. See, this is pyrrole ring. See, 1, 2, 3, 4. So four carbon molecules and one nitrogen molecule, this completely forms a pyrrole ring. So we'll be studying that. Porphyrin and chlorine. Okay, can't see that. Sorry. So this porphyrin and chlorine are the aromatic compounds, and they contain conjugated system, hence they can absorb the electromagnetic radiations, which means conjugated system means they are all a complex structure with more aromatic compounds, and their central compounds with consisting of free electrons, or which means conjugated system, hence they can absorb the electromagnetic radiation easily. Chlorophyll consisting of Mg plus ion in the center, which is covalently attached to two nitrogen atom and coordinately bound with another two nitrogen atom of the pyrrole rings. So as I said, pyrrole consisting of one nitrogen atom. So this central magnesium atom of the chlorophyll, it is attached covalently with two nitrogen atoms and coordinate covalent bond with the other two nitrogen atoms of the pyrrole rings. Coordinate covalent bond means, you know, right? So anyone can say what is a coordinate covalent bond? So next one is cyclopentanone ring is attached to the third pyrrole ring, and the fourth pyrrole ring is attached with the propionic acid and form ester with phytyl tail is attached with that is tetraisoprenoyl alcohol, which means here to the third, 1, 2, 3. So to this third pyrrole ring, there is a cyclopentanone ring is attached, and a particular phytyl, this is tetraisoprenoyl alcohol, this is a phytyl ring, phytyl tail, which is attached to the fourth pyrrole ring. This is the fourth pyrrole ring. To this, a phytyl ring is attached through the propionic acid. This is 1, 2, 3 propionic acid. Phytol is a long branched hydrocarbon chain, and it is derived with four isoprene units, and it is present in only chlorophyll A, B, and D, and not in chlorophyll C. So means this phytol tail is not present in chlorophyll C, but this tail is present in chlorophyll A, B, and D. This is a branched hydrocarbon chain with some of the double bonds here. The R group on the second pyrrole ring can be CH3 in chlorophyll A and CHO in chlorophyll B. So this R group, this particular R group on the second pyrrole ring, if it is CH3, then it is a chlorophyll, and if it is CHO aldehyde group, then it is a chlorophyll B. Same like chlorophyll, we have bacteriochlorophyll, which means that those are present in bacteria, and those are somewhat different than this main chlorophyll molecule. They are present in anoxygenic photosynthetic organism. So same like chlorophyll, there are also different types like A, B, C, D, and E. They absorb higher wavelength than the chlorophyll. So this bacterial chlorophyll can absorb higher wavelength than the chlorophyll molecules. So here we'll be studying what is the main difference between chlorophyll A and chlorophyll B. So chlorophyll A, the chemical formula is C55H72O5N4Mg, and chlorophyll B is C55H70O6N4Mg. So the main difference will be this particular here CH3 molecule and here CHO. So one extra O molecule will be present and two H2 molecules are less in this chlorophyll molecule B. In chlorophyll molecule, in pure state, it is blue green in color. Chlorophyll B in pure state, it is olive green in color. Chlorophyll A, it is an essential photosynthetic pigment, which means it is compulsory essential for the entrapment of light and also act in the main of one of the electron acceptors and donors. So those are essential photosynthetic pigments, but this chlorophyll is accessory photosynthetic pigments. They are mainly used to entrap. So if accessory, they access the light, but they are not mainly used in a photochemical reaction, but they are used in the entrapment of light and then giving that light energy or transferring that light energy to the photochemical reaction center. The chlorophyll A pyrrole ring, second pyrrole ring consisting of methyl group, and in chlorophyll B, the second pyrrole ring consisting of aldehyde group. Okay, chlorophyll A molecule absorb more red wavelength than violet blue wavelength, but this chlorophyll B absorbs more violet blue wavelength than red wavelength. So as I said, they absorb different wavelengths. So in a particular day, we have different light energies. So these chlorophyll, different chlorophyll molecules are used in a different time in a particular day. So when it is more violet blue in color, this chlorophyll A molecule red, this chlorophyll A molecule is used. When it is violet blue, chlorophyll B molecule is used. So as I said, there are different antennae pigments, that is chlorophylls, carotenoids, and phycobilins. So we have studied what is a chlorophyll, different types of chlorophyll, what is a structural component of a chlorophyll. So nextly we'll be studying what is a carotenoid. Till now, any doubts? Please respond. Okay, so carotenoids, it is an accessory pigment that helps absorb light which are not absorbed by chlorophyll. So as I said, these are the accessory pigments. So these are the pigments which are mainly used to absorb light at a different wavelengths. They are not essential, they are accessory. Essential means mostly used in a means main light reaction. These are the accessory. Along with those essential, there are some of the pigments which are used to entrapment of light at a different wavelength. So during the day, we have different wavelengths. So these accessory pigments mainly used to entrap different types of wavelengths at a time in a different day schedule. So it is an accessory pigment that helps absorb light that is not absorbed by chlorophyll. So chlorophyll can absorb only a few wavelengths. Other than those wavelengths, these carotenoids are absorbed. They are also lipid soluble, like chlorophyll also a lipid soluble proteins or pigments. These carotenoids are also lipid soluble. They are long chain conjugated hydrocarbon derivative of isoprene subunits and have different end groups in a different forms. So same like chlorophyll, they are lipid soluble, and these are not heterocyclic compounds, they are long chain compounds. Like chlorophyll is a cyclic compound, but these carotenoids are long chain compounds. They are derivative of isoprene subunits. So isoprene are the subunits of these carotenoids, and they have different end groups in a different forms. So carotenoid, there are different types of carotenoids which have different end groups. So they are generally C40 terpenoid compounds. That means a particular carotenoid consisting of 40 carbon molecules, and which is formed by the condensation of isoprene, 8 isoprene units. Means carotenoids are the derivative of isoprene, that is 8 isoprene units are condensed to form one carotenoid molecule. So there are two types of, means they are subdivided into two types based upon the structure and some of the properties. These carotenoids are mainly divided into xanthophylls and carotenes. Xanthophylls are the carotenoids which do not consisting of oxygen, they contain oxygen, and carotenes, they doesn't consisting of oxygen. So carotenoids are of two types, xanthophyll and carotenes. These carotenoids absorb 400 to 500 nanometers, which is responsible for yellow color of the leaves in the autumn and orange color in carrot. So we know that chlorophyll absorbs like 600 to 700 nanometers, but the lesser wavelength than those are absorbed by these carotenoids, which is 400 to 500 nanometers, and they gives the yellow color to the leaves in the atom. So in atom, the leaves turn yellow due to the presence of carotenoids, and the orange color in carrot is also due to these carotenoids. These carotenoids act as an accessory pigment that capture light and transfer to the reaction center, and also provide protection against photooxidation damage, that is photoprotection. So as I said, these carotenoids are the accessory pigments. They are mainly used in a capturing of light energy and transferring to the reaction center. These carotenoids are also used for the photoprotection. Means these are the these pigments also provide protection against some photooxidation damage, which means like the energy stored in a chlorophyll is excited, is rapidly dispatched by the excitation transfer or photochemical reaction. The excited state is said to be quenched, which means if a chlorophyll molecule absorbs light energy and it gets excited, then that excited state releases an electron or transfer that particular energy to the next pigment, and finally to the photochemical reaction. That excited state is said to be quenched or come to the normal ground state. Quenched means coming back to the ground state, and by giving or releasing that that energy. If the chlorophyll is not rapidly quenched, quenched means coming to the ground state. If that chlorophyll molecule is excited and not rapidly quenched, means they are not coming back to the ground state immediately, then that particular chlorophyll react with the oxygen and convert it into singlet oxygen, which means that excited chlorophyll reacts with the oxygen molecule, and that converts the oxygen into singlet oxygen, which is a very reactive, and this singlet oxygen can damage the D protein of photosystem, lead to the photo inhibition, which means this singlet protein, which something like one electron is extra given to the oxygen, that particular oxygen is very reactive and it forms all the damage in the particular photosystem by damaging this particular D protein in a photosystem. So as I said, a photosystem consisting of different types of protein, D protein is one of the main important protein which help in the photochemical reaction. So this singlet oxygen is used, and it is very reactive, and this mainly highly reactive oxygen damage the D protein of the photosystem. and which finally leads to the photoinhibition, which means it cannot absorb light any further. Carotenoid exert photoprotection by quenching the excited state of the chlorophyll and release that energy in the form of heat. So as I said, quenching means coming back to the ground state. If the chlorophyll doesn't come back to the ground state very rapidly, these carotenoids take those energy from the chlorophyll, the particular excited chlorophyll. From those excited chlorophyll, these carotenoids absorbs that particular energy, and that energy is released in the form of heat. Hence, this carotenoids is called as quencher, means it is bringing down the excited chlorophyll back to the ground state. This quencher thing is a one of the functional thing of this carotenoid, which gives the photo protection. And if toxic photo products are produced, and those are eliminated by the carotenoids, along with the functioning like quencher, means bringing back chlorophyll to the ground state, they also act as a scavenger, means they are removing the some of the toxic products which are produced during this photosynthetic process. There are three different types of carotenoids. There are three different types of xanthophylls. Those are viloxanthin, anthraxanthin, and zeaxanthin. So as I said, there are different types of carotenoids, that are xanthophylls and carotenes. There are again xanthophylls are again three types based upon their structure and chemical properties. So I have given two examples, one for xanthophylls and one for carotene. So lutein is a xanthophyll. So it is a straight hydrocarbon molecule which consisting of methyl groups around it, and it consisting it is a xanthophyll molecule. Lutein is a xanthophyll molecule. This beta carotene is main we have known very commonly, and it is a carotene molecule, carotene type of carotenoid. And mainly the main difference between these thing are these end products. The end products of this hydrocarbon chain are different. So the lutein is a xanthophyll and beta carotene is carotenoid examples. So other type of photosynthetic pigments are phycobilins. We have studied that chlorophyll, carotenoids, and phycobilins are main important antenna pigments. So phycobilins are next type of photosynthetic pigments. So these are also the accessory pigments which are non-cyclic linear tetrapyrrole structure which looks similar to the bilirubin. So these are also accessory pigments which is mainly used for only entrapment of light, and they are also non-cyclic, means they are not like cyclic structure like chlorophyll, and they consisting of linear tetrapyrrole structure, means four pyrrole rings are present, and these phycobilins looks similar to the bilirubin pigment in human. The three types of phycobilins are phycoerythrobilin, phycocyanobilin, and allophycocycobilin. So these are three types of phycobilins, and they are unique because they form a covalent bond with the water soluble proteins and form phycobiliproteins. So these phycobilins forms a covalent bond with the proteins and forms a phycobilin proteins. These phycobilin proteins are of two types, phycoerythrins and phycocyanins. These phycoerythrin and phycocyanin are the complex between the phycobilin pigments and some of the water soluble proteins. These phycobilin proteins are water soluble, Hence, they cannot stay in a thylakoid membrane. So, as we know, thylakoid membrane is a membrane of proteins and lipids. So, these are water soluble. So, they cannot stay within the thylakoid membrane. So, those are aggregated and adhere to the to this thylakoid membrane and forms the phycobilis zones. Phycobilis zones are the aggregated structure of phycobili proteins. So these phycobilins are abundant in red algae and cyanobacteria. So this is one of the example of phycobilin, that is phycocyanin. So in phycoerythrin, instead of CH double bond CH2, it consisting of CH3. So finally, we have studied that there are different types of photosynthetic pigments which absorbs light at different radiations. So they have studied these pigments are different from each other by studying their absorption spectrum. Means each of the pigment absorbs different wavelength of light. So by observing which type of pigment is absorbing which type of wavelength, so they differentiated those photosynthetic pigments. So here we'll be studying absorption and action spectrum. Absorption and action spectrum are the graphs which are drawn for the photosynthetic pigments at a different wavelengths. So photosynthetic pigments absorb electromagnetic radiation in visible and infrared radiations. So in particular, like electromagnetic radiation, mostly these pigments absorb in a visible and infrared regions. So the graph showing the degree of absorption of light by the pigment as a function of wavelength referred to as absorption spectrum. Means here the absorption spectrum is a graph that is drawn. This is an absorption spectrum of the different pigments. So it is a graph drawn between the absorption of light by the particular pigment against the wavelength, means which type of pigment is absorbing which type of wavelength. So how much of the light is absorbed by the pigment, so between those absorption of light and wavelength the graph is drawn. That particular graph is called absorption spectrum. So different pigments consisting of different absorption spectrum. So based upon this absorption spectrum, all the pigments are differentiated from each other, and a graph shown degree to which different wavelength affect the photochemical reaction is called action spectrum. So as we know, there are different photosynthetic pigments absorb different wavelengths, and also each pigments have the different photochemical reaction process also. So if a graph drawn between how much the photochemical reaction takes place against the wavelength, that particular graph is called action spectrum. Means how much particular action is done by the different pigments is seen in this particular graph. How this action spectrum graph is drawn means, in oxygenic photosynthetic organism, the action spectrum is plotted between photochemical reaction in the form of oxygen evolution and wavelength. So we directly don't calculate what is the net product of photochemical reaction. Instead of, we are taking how much of oxygen is evolved in a particular organism by a particular pigment. So by using how much oxygen is evolved by the particular pigment at a different wavelengths, the graph is drawn. This particular graph is called action spectrum. So during the photosynthesis process, photochemical reaction performed by the chlorophyll A produce oxygen due to the photolysis of water. So based upon the how much of oxygen is released by the photolysis of water, based upon the amount of oxygen released, we will calculate how much the photochemical reaction takes place. So based upon that, the graph is drawn for the action spectrum. So that is the difference between absorption spectrum and action spectrum. In absorption, we'll take different wavelength and how much of light is absorbed in the absorption spectrum. But in action spectrum, we'll be taking how much of oxygen is released, that which how much of chemical photochemical reaction takes place against the wavelength of light for a particular pigment. So we'll for a graph for different pigments, there are different absorption spectrum and action spectrum. So based upon those absorption and action spectrum, different chemical different properties of these pigments are studied. Means how much of these pigments absorbs the light and how much the photochemical reaction takes place is all studied by this particular spectrum, particular graphs. So that's it. Any doubts? So yes, the pigments, all these different types of chlorophylls and phycobilins, all these pigments are present. Okay. All these all these carotenoids and phycobilins are present in the antennae complex. So as I said, the thylakoid membrane. So 1 minute. So this particular, it is a thylakoid membrane. So membrane consisting of different proteins and pigments. So I have given this. So this is a thylakoid membrane. And it is consisting of different proteins. So these are the proteins along with some of the electron acceptors and donors. And along with this, along the thylakoid membrane, the pigments are present on the thylakoid membrane itself. All these chlorophylls, carotenoids, and phycobilins, they are besides each other. All these are the core antennae molecules, which means they are present beside the photochemical reaction, and there are some of the peripheral antennae compounds around the core antennae molecule, so which transfers the energy finally to the photosystem. So all the pigments are present in the antennae complex, yes, and the resonance transfer. No, the absorption and action spectrum are different. Absorption spectrum is only how much light is absorbed, but the action spectrum is a how much energy, how much the chemical reaction takes place in a by a particular pigment is done. So those are different. So those cannot be overlapped. So those are two different graphs. And resonance transfer means so as I said, though there are so many pigments like chlorophylls, carotenoids, and phycobilins, they are placed side by side each other. So all those pigments directly they don't give to the reaction center. They are transferred one by one to each other. Means one pigment is transferred to the another, and that here we will be seeing. So from the light reaction is trapped by this particular pigment. This energy is transferred to this pigment and then to this and then to this and finally to the reaction center. This is a resonance transfer. Means the energy is transferred from one by one. Not all these pigments are not directly given to the reaction center, but they are transferred from one by one and finally to the reaction center. That is called resonance electron transfer. Okay. So can I ask some questions like, what is the main proton donors in oxygenic and anoxygenic photosynthetic organisms? So I have told this, but so like in oxygenic photosynthetic organisms, water is used as a proton donor. And in anoxygenic photosynthetic organisms, other than water, like H2S, H2, and some of the sulfide, direct only sulfide molecules are also used in anoxygenic photosynthetic organisms. They only give the electrons other than the protons. So if there is any doubt, you can ask, or else give those answers to these questions, like what is the difference between chlorophyll A and B, and what is a quencher, and which of this chlorophyll molecule doesn't consisting of phytyl ring, and I think time is also up.
Students, if you still have doubt, you can put it in the chat box, or else we will stop the class over here. Please use the chat box to respond.
Yes. But the main difference is the chlorophyll A molecule consisting of methyl CH3 group, and the chlorophyll B consisting of aldehyde group. Yeah, that is also it. So which of the pigment is called as quencher? So carotenoid is a pigment called as quencher because it helps in the photoprotection by absorbing light from the excited chlorophyll. Yeah, carotenoid, yes. So which of the chlorophyll does not consisting of phytyl tail? Yeah, it's chlorophyll C. Yeah, thank you. Chlorophyll C does not consist of a phytyl tail.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for the wonderful presentation. I request the students, please do not leave the meeting.
So the main difference between chlorophyll C and D, there is some structural changes only. Like in chlorophyll C, it does not consisting of a phytyl tail, but chlorophyll D consisting of a phytyl tail. And their absorption spectrum is also different. Okay. Any doubts you can ask. Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you.
Ma'am, you can leave the meeting. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am.